want to hear more from Malcolm. We are so excited to be with us this morning. Before we get into service, let's go over a couple of announcements. October 5th, we're having a free lunch from the parking lot. Now, we really need volunteers for this event, so if you would like to volunteer time, please give Ms. Nikki for more details. We're also going to be selling shirts, so if you would like to pre-order one of our Freedom Recovery shirts to wear at the event, give them to that as well. September 28th, we'll be getting together as a church family to have a movie night and watch Jesus Revolution. So if you would come, bring your families, maybe eat some popcorn, and let's have a good time fellowshipping together as a church family. Our church is in the process of accepting new members. If you would like to become a member of our church, then there are membership cards to fill out in the back. You'll just fill them out, put them in the offering box, and we're going to be having a class September 21st to welcome in the new members. We would absolutely love to have you join us. This Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, our church will be attending the Eddie James Shift Conference in Hot Springs. Now, this will be a Thursday night, Friday night, and then Saturday and Saturday night service. The Thursday and Friday night will start at 7, and then Saturday, the service will start at 2 and at 6. Now, if you want to be carrying a seed of revival, if you need a fresh inpouring, if you need a fresh spiritual foot washing, then please join us, and let's go and let's get a taste of revival together to bring it back and to plant it here on our own. If you scan out your phone, it'll take you to a website called Tithely, where you can donate your tithe and offering to the church. You're even able to give if you have a guest speaker specifically to that speaker. Now, if you'd rather do checks or cash, then we have an offering box in the back where you can give. Every Monday through Thursday, from 8 to 9, we have prayer together as a congregation. Now, if we want to be a church that impacts our community, that walks in power and authority, that when people come to the altar, they get healed miraculously, they get delivered, they get set free, then we need to charge up our spirits together in unity as prayer. Pentecost only comes when we're together as one praying. We want to have revival until it comes, and only comes when we're together in prayer. So please, please, if you're able to, join us together every Monday through Thursday from 8 to 9 for prayer. Thank you so much for joining us. We're so excited that you're here to worship with us and to hear a word from the Lord. Now, let's set our hearts, let's get ready, and let's see what God's going to do today.
Sister Dan, we're going to go around the hymns for their prayer.
No. Hallelujah. You can be seated this morning, and it's good to see all of you in the house of the Lord today. We're gonna do something that we hadn't done since I've been here. We're gonna dedicate a baby today. She gave him the love, but we're gonna get him back. This is not just any baby. This is my baby. Amen. This is one of our grandchildren, and he's a lot like his mother. And really is. This other one here is a different story, but this one's like his mother. I won't ever forget when I came home from work one day, and we already had Samantha Joe, and Cindy said, sit down, I got to talk to you. And I said, okay. And she just busted out bawling, and she said, I'm pregnant, and I can't take another one like this. This one right here on the front row, Andrea, and but she come in the world, and she's just been she was the best little baby and the best kid. She's really been good, never give us any problems. We got four grandsons now, and this last one here has been the best baby out of all of them. The rest of them's awful. But this one right here, he's a dandy. So if you will, y'all bring them up here. Grandma, just come stand right here. And just right there, be good. That'll be good. Y'all just kind of face the congregation there just a minute. And there we go. She's up and down. This is Josiah Timothy Sumner, and you've named your baby really well. Josiah means God supports, and God heals, and God helps. And we know that Josiah in the Bible was the last good king that Israel ever had. And I believe that this generation right here will be the last good generation on earth before the coming of the king. Josiah was the last good king before the king came. His middle name is Timothy. And Timothy means honoring God, and in God's honor or honored by God. And so if Timothy grows up honoring God, then God will honor him all the days of his life. He'll have his respect, and he'll have God's values, and he'll be of great importance to this world if he follows God. And then his last name is Sumner. And Sumner is a person who serves a summons that you have to appear in court. And you know, he's from the Burrow family now. He's only going to be blessed all the days of his life. And who knows, he may grow up and be just like his big daddy. And he'll give summons. He'll summons people to let them know that there's coming a judgment day. We're all going to stand in the court of heaven and be judged for the deeds done in our body, whether good or whether bad. And so if little Josiah grows up to what he's been named, he will be something for the Lord. And so today, as we dedicate him to the Lord, as Hannah prayed for a man child, and God gave her one, and she gave him back to the Lord all the days of his life. That's what we're doing today. Only God knows what kind of potential is in that little fellow right there, and the gifts and the talents and what all he'll be able to do in his life. But we're going to pray for him and dedicate him, and so you'll have to give him to me to do that. If you will stand, and I want you to stretch your hands toward this baby and toward this family, and I want us to pray as we dedicate him to the Lord. Father, we thank you for Josiah Timothy Sumner. Lord, I pray they've named this baby really well. Lord, that he will grow up and that he will live up to his name. God, let him be blessed all the days of his life. And God, I pray that you would bring out of him everything that you put in him. Lord, that you would guide him and lead him, Lord. I pray for every teacher that will teach him in the house of God. And Lord, that he'll grow up knowing how to pray, because he'll hear his mother and father praying. And Lord, he'll grow up being faithful to church, because this mother and father's going to take him to church. And God, I ask you, Lord, that you would pull out of him everything you put in him, and that he would be blessed, Lord, in health. And Lord, that he'd be wealthy, God, and that he would be a mighty man of valor of God one day. Lord, I ask you that you would bless the church family, Lord, that'll help mold him and make him, and let him be everything you want him to be. We give him to you, Lord. You've given him to us, and we give him back to you today. We dedicate him and his life to you. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Y'all ready on the microphone, so it must be. Praise God. God bless you. Thank you so much. You can be seated. Praise the Lord. Thank you all so much. I got a Bible and I left it in the office. I'll give it to them afterwards. So.
Oh,
today. Oh God, I ask you that your kingdom would come, that your will would be done today, Lord, even as it is in heaven. Lord, we need you like we've never needed you before. God, we're desperate, Lord. We don't just want you. We don't just need you. We gotta have you, Lord. It's you or die, Lord. It's sink or swim, Lord, without you, Lord. We're nothing without you, but we can do all things through you. We want you. We want you, Lord. Move among us today. Yes, Lord, this is the very air we breathe. We live, we breathe, we move, we have our being in you. Oh, Lord, can you sing it one more time? This is the air I breathe. We won't be giving it to anybody, but we want to know when your birthday is and your anniversary and how many children that you claim and all of that. They got the handout. And if you will, just turn those back into that box where the offering box is in the back. And that Indian will let you put that in there. Right? Or money, or that. He'll let you put that in there. But anything else? Praise God. And did y'all run out of membership cards? Hey, we've run out. You got, okay. Well, I tell you what, you run out of membership cards. I've got one left up here. You can have this one. And we will have some more next week. Next Sunday is the deadline for the membership. But if you will, Brother Hayden will get us some more. And you can, they're back there, they'll be on that back little table back there in the back. But we've got to know exactly who's wanting to join us. So, we can't just do that last minute. We got to prove you as a board, and then we're going to have a little come to Jesus meeting. No, we're going to have a membership class. We're going to let you meet all the leaders and let all the leaders meet you and what you can expect from the church and what the church should expect from you. Now, praise the Lord. I don't know about y'all, but I've been chasing grandsons the last day or so, and my house has totally changed. I went from dolls and makeup and barbecue, you know, all that thing kind of thing, to now it's some trucks and knives, and it's fixed to be guns. And son-in-laws don't know it, but yeah. And they got the oldest one's pocket knives. They wanted to carry them to church today, you know. So anyway, but one of the son-in-laws was fussing about it. I said, you better hush, because guns is next. Race cars, four-wheelers, this is, life is good at the Borough House. Amen. But I am just the way I am, and it's because I've been raised around a bunch of women. That's what's the whole deal. And I'm coming out of my shell. If you have your Bible with you this morning, we're going to be in the book of Ruth again, chapter number 3. We've been looking at Ruth for the last few Sundays. And Joshua judges Ruth, 1 Samuel. Ruth chapter 3 and verse number 1. We're going to look at her maybe next Sunday too. Tonight is miracle service night. So if you need a miracle, know somebody needs one, then you bring them. Get them here tonight. We're going to be taking communion, and we're going to pray for miracles tonight. If you have it, could you stand one more time if you don't mind? Ruth chapter 3, verse number 1. It says, then Naomi, her mother-in-law, said unto her, my daughter, shall not I seek rest for thee, that it may be well with thee. And now is not Boaz of our kindred, with whose maidens thou wast? Behold, he went with barley tonight in the threshing floor. Wash thyself therefore, and anoint thee, and put thy raiment upon thee, and get thee down to the floor. But make not thyself known unto the man until he shall have done eating and drinking. And it shall be when he lieth down, that thou shalt mark the place where he shall lie. And thou shalt go in and uncover his feet and lay thee down, and he will tell thee what thou shalt do. And she said unto her, all that thou sayest unto me, I will do. And she went down unto the floor and did according to all that her mother-in-law bade her. Lord, I ask you today that you would anoint me, you would lead me, God. May help me, Lord, this morning to stir up the gift of God that you placed in me, that I could feed this flock of God today. Lord, I know you know every person in here, that everyone that's going to hear this word today through the internet or in this house. And I just pray, God, that it would be relevant to every person with ears to hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. God, I ask you today to open the eyes of our understanding, that we may know what is the hope of our calling and what the riches of the inheritance is in the saints. And God, that we could walk in your power, in your exceeding great and mighty power. Lord, I pray that this word would come alive and every person that hears it today. God, I ask you now to be glorified and let your church be edified. And Lord, let every demon in Hot Spring County, Lord, be terrified. God, I ask you this morning that you would be, you would show yourself mighty among us. Lead us, guide us, and direct us. And we're going to praise you for what you do around these altars today. Alter us, change us, make us into your image. And we're going to praise you. And in Jesus' name we ask it. And everybody that believes would say,
amen.
Amen and amen. You can be seated this morning. We've been studying out of the book of Ruth now the last few Sundays, and hopefully I'm going to try to finish it up maybe next week. But last week we talked about you can make it happen, and we're going to go a little deeper there. You can make it happen. Look at your neighbor and say, something needs to happen in you. Something needs to happen. It needs to. I don't know if this has helped you as much as it's helped me, but this little book of Ruth has literally changed me and challenged me, and I hope it has you also. And you know, we found out that Ruth truly is gives us a panoramic view, an ever-widening view on how to live by faith and go from faith to faith and glory to glory. She's kind of sandwiched, you know, right between the judges and Joshua, judges, then there's Ruth, and then there's 1 Samuel. She's kind of like the ham in the ham sandwich, you know. It's just the best part, I mean. And so she gives us insight and a working knowledge of how to receive the blessings and promises of God. Anybody in here want to receive the blessings and promises? Anybody got a promise from God, that God has promised you something? You see it in His Word. He confirmed it to you in His Spirit. And I want to make it happen. How about you? I want it to happen. And I do believe if we'll take these principles or golden nuggets, we can take them to the exchange center, and we can trade gold for money, or we can take the Word of God to the promises of God, or we can receive and claim the promises of God. So last week we talked about Ruth and Naomi on you can make it happen, how Naomi wanted it to be well for her, that she could find rest. And I believe that's what God the Holy Ghost is wanting for us. He's wanting us to labor to enter into that resting place in God. That's Hebrews chapter number 4. It really doesn't make a lot of sense. You labor to enter into a rest. But if you work hard enough and get to a place in God that you're waiting on Him to do it, that's the resting place. That's a great place to be, that you just know down in your knower He's going to do it. Amen. Amen. And y'all looking at me kind of funny, but we're going to go somewhere if you'll just stay with me. But she'd been advising her and helping her how to live a life of faith. You know, Ruth come right straight out of Moab and didn't know nothing and absolutely anything at all. And so she's come this far. You know, we talked about at the very beginning, the best is yet to come. They were broke, busted, disgusted. I mean, they lost stuff and didn't know if they'd ever get it back, but they hadn't read chapter 3 and 4 yet. Uh-huh. And then we talked about once you start following God, you make our God your God, the God of the Bible, then start walking, working in faith, how things start falling into place. And then we found out favor ain't fair, but it's good. Amen. And you will. If you'll follow God, things will start falling into place right before you. I mean, He'll drop handfuls on you. You wonder, how in the world did not somebody pick that up and before I got there to it? But no, God had it laid out for you, and because He's showing you favor. So favor is not fair, but it is good. God never said in His Word that He gave he had favorites, but he does have favor. He will give you favor, but it's not fair, nor does it say God is fair. It's not fair that I get to go to heaven, that I get called by his name, that he put me in the ministry, because there's a lot more qualified and a lot of people that lived a lot better life than I did before he called me. But thank God, favor ain't fair. Amen. I'm glad God ain't fair. But then we talked about how to make it happen, and I want to go a little bit deeper into that, because I believe we're to the point we want stuff to happen, don't we? I do. And so Naomi's name, it means my joy, my bliss, or spiritual joy. It means the pleasantness of Jehovah. And so we've been looking at Naomi as a representative of God the Holy Ghost. And God the Holy Ghost will give you the joy of the Lord. And that will become your strength. And in his presence is fullness of joy and pleasures evermore. What a joy it is to know that if I listen, he'll guide me into all truths, that I got a helper that lives with me. He'll speak to me. He'll show me how to go out and how to come in. And Ruth's name is amazing to me. It means something worth seeing, or a friend of God. And if you will follow the workings of the Holy Ghost, I will tell you, you will be something worth seeing. When you become a friend of God, if you listen and follow the Holy Spirit of God, you'll be somebody that's worth seeing. Actually, people will want to be like you, and they'll want to have what you have. I want to be so blessed that people are jealous. I want people to say that he looks like a Pentecostal preacher. He's level. He's got the bubble right in the middle. I mean, he sounds like a Pentecostal preacher. He acts like a Pentecostal preacher. If you want to see a real one, go down there to North Mountain of Synagogue. I want preachers eating their heart out. I want to be like it is with me and Dean Caldwell. He just makes me sick every time I hear him preach. I've read the Bible 103 times, and I can't stand out in front of the pulpit and quote it like he does. I mean, it just makes me want to go fast and pray when I hear Dean Caldwell preach, because I want to be like him. But I'll tell you, if you'll follow the Spirit of God, you'll be something worth seeing, and people will want to be like you. And I will tell you, the Holy Spirit, Naomi, will guide you into all truth, and the truth will set you free. And the truth will keep you free. Somebody ought to say amen. I'm starting to feel my help in here. You're looking at me like a bunch of hoot owls up in a tree. I want you to know God will make you something worth seeing. I want to get the devil's attention myself. I do. I want to be so blessed that the devil has to go to Walmart and buy some 72-hour Old Spice deodorant, because he's sweating so bad that I'm up here again. I want to make the devil sweat because he's following God again. God's blessing them all over again. I wish somebody just helped me just a little. If not, I'm going to preach till service tonight. Oh Lord, well, let me move on. But we talked last week about how to make things happen. That the first thing we got to know what we're going after. We got to have a goal, a target, and remember, a goal is a dream with a deadline on it. And so Naomi picked out the goal and the target for Ruth to have. And if you'll follow God, God the Holy Spirit will show you what you can become and what you can be and what you can have and what you can do. You can go for it. And y'all remember we talked about that. And so then we talked about she had to wash herself. And you know, I can't recap it all because somebody's on the front row this morning. It's kind of like, y'all know that I heard this story about this parrot, and this fella took him to the grocery store, and the parrot could talk, and so he walked by this lady that was rather large, and the parrot when he went by, he said, "Hello there, fat so," and made that woman madder than an old wet sitting hen. And she went to the manager, and the poor Perry didn't get banned, but he had to sit on the beach right there as you go out. And so the man had to leave the parrot right there at the beach. And so he went off shopping, and sure enough, here come that lady through the checkout line. And the parrot's sitting there just looking at her, and she's looking at him. And she checks out and goes by, and he looked at her. He said, "Hey, woman." And she turned, and he said, "You know." He didn't say it, but you know, y'all that was here last week, I can't say it because you know, all right. But she had to wash herself. She said to wash yourself, you know, wash your face. And you got to get the Word of God and loose them clinging issues from your past. You're not in Moab no more. You're in Bethlehem today. You're in the house of God. You're not one of them anymore. You got to wash yourself and then anoint yourself. Stir up the Holy Spirit that's inside you. Build yourself up in the most holy faith. Pray it in the Holy Ghost. You got to change your attitude. Nobody likes to be around somebody with a bad attitude. That's why nobody likes to see me in the morning time. Yes, I'm sorry, it's just not good, but nobody likes to hang around somebody. I mean, Brother Keith, we was playing golf one day, and I was getting all mad, and I didn't chuck a club, but I mean, if I'd have spit it, it'd set the golf course on fire. I was so mad, and he kind of put his arm around me. You know, he's the man of the pastor, and he put his arm around me. He said, "Now, Brother Preacher," he said, "you don't play good enough to get mad." And nobody likes it. Well, it's ruining his game too, you know. And so I got it. I mean, you know, it did well anyway. I got to move on. But that's the kind of friend I have. And so you have to change your attitude yourself sometimes. You just have to. And I can't go back about the biscuit story today. All right. But God doesn't even like somebody with a bad old attitude, because he said, "Come into my presence with singing and enter into my courts with joy and praise." And God don't want to see no bad attitude. You should enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. And so you have to anoint yourself. We can anoint you, but we can only do it on Sunday and Wednesday. And you got to do it yourself the rest of the week. Oh, yeah. I know you got happy coming to church, though. Yeah, everybody gets happy coming to church unless you were drug up here. But if you were drug, that's all right. Long as you hear, you close enough to the creek, you can fall plumb in. But then she told her, she said, "You need to change your clothes." In other words, dress up for where you're headed. You got to act like it's true before it ever even happens. And so you should have walked in here this morning wearing your faith. I mean, the devil ought to be looking at you and see where you're headed. People ought to notice something about you, that you're a man of faith. You're a woman of faith. You're dressing up like it happens before it ever. In other words, build your ark before it ever even rained. Oh, pray for rain and it's never, and go buy you a brand new umbrella at Walmart. I mean, you know, I'm going to be a millionaire, so I'm going to start acting like I'm giving like one. Woo, help me, God. I'm just trying to show you that you need to show God that you believe. I know you'll look ridiculous for a little while, but you won't after you start receiving it. But you got to change your clothes. She couldn't go to Boaz looking like a peasant and looking like a servant, because she wasn't no Moabite no more. She had just as much right to the promises and the dictates of God than an Israelite born in the middle of it. And I come to tell somebody this morning, it don't matter if you just got off the street last week and got saved. You got just as much right as somebody that was carried in here 9 months before they were born and raised in here. You got just as much right to every promise of God as anybody else. So put your old self on, put on them new clothes, and act like it's the truth. She instructed her. She instructed, you got to wear your faith. And you know, Columbo ought to be able to figure out who you are and where you're headed. Oh, there ought to be enough clues on you.
Come on.
Oh, there ought to be enough evidence around you of where you're headed and what you're going after. If you've got a goal, do I have a witness? Are you understanding what I'm saying? She, Naomi had picked out a Boaz for her, and she was dressed to get a man. Hello. And so, well, I got to move on, but that was last week. If you missed it, you'll just have to go back and re-listen to it. But then she told her, she said, you got to get down there. You can't stay where you're at now, honey. You're washed. You're anointed. You got your clothes on. Now you need to get down there to where that man's at. You got to go to the place. You see, ladies and gentlemen, the blessing, it's going to come. But yeah, you have to go to the place in order to receive it. You got to go somewhere. Have you ever noticed when depression comes on you, all you want to do is lay up in the bed and stay at the house and don't want to see nobody, don't want to hear nobody? Y'all know what it is. Y'all know all about that, don't you? And it's because you want to lock yourself in a room. And the reason that is the devil knows in order to receive certain blessings, you've got to be at certain places with certain people in order to receive it. And so the devil will do everything he can. He can't stop you from washing and anointing and dressing yourself, but he'll do everything he can possible to keep you from getting to the place so that you can receive your blessing. I wish somebody say amen. If you're getting what I'm saying, I want you to help me just a little. It's dangerous to stay too long in the place of the wrong when you're overdressed for where you're headed and you're not there yet.
Come on.
Because you kind of look a little ridiculous. And so I want you to think about, let me explain it just a little bit. I'm not doing what I did last week. All right, I'm not going there. But if you're going to a wedding, and you're a part of the wedding, and that means that you're going to have on your tux or your formal dress, and you come out to the motel room, I mean, fitting to kill, looking good, and get in the elevator and ride it down to the lobby. As long as you're doing all that, you're just fine. People will look at you and say, yeah, oh, they're going to a wedding. I mean, they're going to some kind of special event. I mean, got the black tie, the tux, the bow tie. I mean, shining and profiling and all cleaned up. But yeah, you know, you may look a little overdressed for where you're at for a little while. But then if you just sat down in the lobby and sat there 3 or 4 hours, you're going to look literally ridiculous. People is going to walk by and say, have they lost their ever-loving mind? Do they not know where they're at? I mean, they're walking around with flip-flops and Hawaiian shirts on and short breeches everywhere, and some of them not even wearing enough clothes to, well, let me not get there, but I mean, y'all know what I'm talking about. And here you are, dressed for some special event, and you're not there. You can't stay where you're at trying to be where you're going. Are you hearing what I'm saying? And so once you get dressed for your position, anointed for it, in order to get the blessing, you got to head for it. Somebody in here has been washed and anointed and got your clothes on for a new position on your job or to enter into the ministry or to do something in the church. But yet we have set to long on the pew and wonder why here I am with all this anointing, all this word. I'm looking good, cleaned up inside and out, and still sitting on a pew. You'll never truly receive the real blessings from God until you get up and start heading towards your blessing. Lord, it's getting, I know you're pinching up, but I can't have it. God sent me by to tell you, if he's called on you, he'll give it to you. If he's given you a talent, if he's given you a gift, and if you don't get up and go after it, you're going to get left behind before it's all said and done. Mm-hmm. If you can miss an opportunity and may never get it back. Hello. The windows of opportunity are only open so long. The doors are only open so long. And then if you're not careful, it'll move on past you. And so in order to receive the blessings and my promises, I have to move toward what I'm headed for. Are you hearing me? Now, I can't dress up for the gym and come to church. I can't dress up for the swimming pool to go to church, because that's not what I plan on doing when I get to church. I'm not going to, well, I am going to sweat, but I ain't going to lift weights and run and do all that stuff like I do at the gym. I dress for one way for the gym, another way for church. And so you are in church today, and so you ought to be wearing faith for that. I don't want to be dressed for my past. I won't tell you, your past, if you're not careful, will get you real uncomfortable when God gets ready to take you to a new level and a new position. If you're not careful, you see, I don't fit where I came from, but I actually don't feel like I fit where I'm supposed to be. Anybody ever been there and done that? All I can talk about is me. I mean, I come out of a log truck, and I wore them overalls and them boots and all that, and I was all right at it. I made pretty good. I done good at it. But when God called me to preach, I'm gonna tell you, I got comfortable driving a log truck and fooling with the DOT. I learned how to get around everything. I mean, I could fix stuff, I could do all kinds of things, but when I come out of that and I'm headed to this right here, I was about feeling like a square peg in a round hole, and then you get that feeling of, I don't feel like I deserve that, and I shouldn't be that, and you'll have people tell you that too. Because I couldn't fit in the log woods much longer, because it was just driving me crazy about preaching when Naomi, the Holy Ghost, begins to give you something. You just can't stay there, because it's amazing. You'll feel it's lonely to be successful, and especially if you're moving from faith to faith, because you're never going to feel like the level you're headed to. You're never comfortable until you get there for a while.
That's right.
Now, I knew I tied the tie this morning, and I got it right the second or third time. Woo! But the first time, I didn't even know how to tie a tie when I started it. And I was real uncomfortable. I told you what Jason Anderson said to me. So, Brother Tommy Lincoln told us all right, start selling suits. Toys R Us become his boss before it was over with. Thank God. But you may not fit where you're headed, but you will not be able to stay where you're at and be comfortable. You might be comfortable at it and can do it with your eyes closed, but if God's calling you to go further, I will tell you that if you don't ever try it, you won't never feel what God can really experience, what God can really do for you. God has been even stretching me now. I mean, I've been getting to preach these big preachers' events, and at the end of this month, we're going down there to Houston, and they'd be coming from all over the world. First time I went to that empowerment conference, I felt like a welfare preacher, and the welfare preacher finna get a 15-minute window on the stage. I mean, I don't feel comfortable, but I had a woman prophesy to me a couple of years ago at camp meeting, and she didn't know me, but she come grab me, and she said, God's fixing to put you in a different circles that you've never been in. You're going to run with a crowd you've never run with before. You don't think you're able, but God has already let me know to tell you it is down in you. Now, I may not feel comfortable, but I can tell you I got a word for them preachers that's going to be there, and they finna get a mouthful in 15 minutes. But I'm just here to tell you that if God it moves you, you'll never feel comfortable where you're headed. If you do, it's probably not God doing it.
Amen.
Can you imagine now? Here Ruth is all dressed up to go ask a rich royal Jew to marry her, and she's right out of Moab. Huh? Do you understand? In other words, right straight out of the prison. Right out of a terrible divorce. You see what I'm saying? You feel uncomfortable. And don't you know, all of them looking at her, who does that boy about think she is? Lord, look at her coming to church and looking all spirited like she finna get a man. And who would even want somebody like her? Didn't even know that she was going after not just a man, but the man. Amen. So it's kind of lonely if you're going to be successful with God. And so you have to be prepared to be a misfit. I want you to say that out loud. Say, I have to be a misfit. If I'm going, I'm dressed for it. I ain't going to feel right about it for a little while. But I'm going to tell you, once God gets to helping you, you've got a strong support system with you. But you can't get to the level of blessing that God wants to take you if you are not a misfit. Because we've never been this way here to four. And so in order to get in, you got to come out. And you got to come out in order to get in. And so the place of blessing is where you have to be in position that God can give you. And you will not feel comfortable at it. May not feel worthy. But you are right where you're supposed to be. Whether you feel out of place or not. If God gave it to you. If God has opened the door. Stop feeling sorry for yourself. Stop feeling unworthy. The God that made you who you are is the God that's putting you where He wants you to be. Whether you're comfortable or not, He will make it happen if you'll leave the place where you're at and trust Him on the way. Are y'all hearing me this morning? And you know, I tell you, it's amazing to me how that when you do a new thing, It's like, God, how can I be here? I won't ever forget that. And you don't need to make a bunch of decisions. And talk yourself out of it. Huh? Yeah, you can talk yourself plumb out of it. And so, you don't need to blow the miracle moment.
Come on.
You don't want to blow it by just sitting there. You know, Joseph had to move from Canaan to Egypt. He had to move from daddy's house to the slave house. And then he went to the jail house, to the White House. So he went from prisoner to politician. And instantly got position, a wife, everything. I mean, you know, just like it don't take God long to do anything. But yet, you got to be willing to go. It never crossed his mind that them dreams would happen in Egypt and not in Canaan. They did affect Canaan heavily. But I will tell you, God sometimes, He'll have to have you to move in order to be blessed. So Naomi tells her. Now, I want to tell you something else. When she said, when you get there now, you're going to move. And she goes, she's dressed, she's washed, she's anointed, and she's on her way. But she said, when you get there, I don't want you to say one word. I want you to keep your mouth shut. Don't go in that place and try to make something happen for yourself. All God wants us to do is to get in place, and then you have to wait on the Lord. Isn't that just a terrible thing? I mean, it's kind of like pulling into the Sonic and pushing that red button and ordering, and then you got to watch the clock. You know, it's clicking off the waiting period, and you can't say nothing, and you can't do nothing. It's a terrible place to be on an airplane buckled up, and the thing sitting there going, shh. And it's setting still. I mean, you know what I'm saying? And she tells her, don't you say a word. Don't you say nothing. Now here she is already, but yet she tells her to hush. And she had to wait for it. Because I'll tell you, a lot of times when you go to a place and you start trying to tell what you already know. I'll never forget my first church when I knew I was going to be the pastor. I start thinking, I'm going to put this one here. I'm going to put that one there and this there, and when I got there, they left. So it's a good thing I didn't tell nobody, and I threw my list away. You know what I mean? And so that's what I'm saying. You don't need to speak premature. She said, you walk down there, washed, dressed, anointed, and don't you say a word. Doesn't that kind of sound familiar? If you read the book of Joshua, chapter number 6, when they came to Jericho, they came from Gilgal to Jericho. It was a 7-mile walk and a 7-mile walk back to Gilgal. They did that for 7 days. It was a 0.5 mile around Jericho. They had to, and you notice they had the Ark of the Covenant with them. They walked around Jericho 0.5 mile, walked 7 miles back after they'd been circumcised. Now, I'm not going to get there and mess with that right now. But they had to walk 7.5 miles, and then 7 miles back. They did that 6 days, and then on the 7th day, they walked 0.5 mile 7 times. I believe that's 3.5 if I've ciphered it up right, or close to it anyway. And 3.5 miles on top of them, 7 miles before the walls come down. What are you trying to say, preacher? There comes a time that you got to walk with God and not say a word. Because if you say it before you got to walk with Him, it'll never happen. That's why we got a church world today that can't make miracles happen. Oh, they speak it and they say all kind of stuff, but it don't happen because they ain't got to walk with God. They ain't been carrying Him on their shoulders. And they're not dwelling in the secret place of the Most High. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. If you're not walking in a secret place with God, you'll have a secret life out there that nobody but God and the devil knows about. Woo! Girlfriend, you go down there, but don't you say nothing. Israel, you go over there, but don't you talk yourself out of it. Because y'all know how we are. The power of death and life is in the tongue. And they that love us shall eat the fruits thereof. And we good by speaking death instead of life. Y'all have to come to Wednesday night. I'm fishing to start giving them speech therapy. If God wants to change anything, He'll change your mouth before He changes anything else.
That's right.
Every bit of the kingdom of God is voice activated and motion sensor. Learned that right out of an airport. Man, you walk in a bathroom in an airport, everything is motion sensored. Man, you ain't got to touch it. You just wave something and it come popping out. You didn't even got to, it'll even flush it for you when you leave. It just amazes to me. Now we can just talk to the phone and it'll tell, you tell Sarah what you want her to do. So I'm just trying to tell you that you don't need to get to your blood. There comes a time you gotta wait. If you gotta, and waiting is my worst thing in the whole wide world. How about you? Yeah, I know. And so when God opens the door, I'm gonna tell you it's a mind-boggling thing, but sometimes you gotta be quiet until it happens. You can only say so much, and then you need to hush up about it. And so, ladies and gentlemen, if you're walking into a situation before God sets the door and opens the door, sometimes you just got to keep your mouth shut. And so if you'll keep your mouth shut until it happens, and the Bible says, I see her sitting there, and she's waiting. And you know, what does that old song say? He may not come when you want him, but He's always right on time, and He always brings more than enough. And they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles, and run and not be weary, and walk and not faint. You don't need to speak until He speaks to you. When Jesus speaks to you, now's the time. Now's the time. You can start telling Him what you know, giving Him that covenant promise. He woke up and said, who's there? She said, it's Ruth, and would you be my Valentine? Deuteronomy says that you're supposed to take me up, you're supposed to marry me, and take care of me and Naomi from now on. Could you imagine? He knew exactly what she was talking about. He said, "You are exactly right, sweetie. I will make this happen." He gave her a knapsack full of confirmation. Said, "Take this back to Naomi and tell her I'm on it." When she come walking in with a knapsack full of grain, she said, "What happened?" She said, he sent this back to you. And Naomi said this, Jesus is on it now. You've labored, now you entered into that resting point. You've spoke at the right time. You're washed, you're anointed, you can receive it now. Now we've got a God that'll make it happen. Ruth didn't have to do nothing else. All she had to do was wait on it. And a few days later, she went from borrowing and gleaning and in a little old field and working with the maidens to she became the matriarch of the whole shebang. She became the wife of the rich royal Boaz because Boaz made it happen. We've got a Jesus that's been looking and watching, walking up and down the earth, seeking and searching, looking for somebody to show himself strong to, somebody that'll keep quiet when they need to and open their mouth when they need to. He's looking for somebody that's washed and anointed and got your faith on, and that God will make it happen.
I believe in the days to come, God's going to do things right here that you never dreamed could have. How did that happen? Because of that crazy preacher.
Come on.
And them crazy deacons just followed him. They believed it. And look, here it is. I believe, ladies and gentlemen, if we will do what Ruth did, we can have... I'm going to tell you, I'm not interested in just pastoring the church. I'm not interested in holding on until I retire. I don't ever plan to retire. I'm sorry, y'all got me till death do us part, all right? I am still going to organize a security team next board meeting too, all right, so that y'all can't kill me. In the status quo. I'm not interested. I ain't even trying to build Tony no more. I tried building Tony. Tony can't build nothing. Tony can't build a ministry. Tony can't build a church. But I tell you what Tony Boy can do. Tony Boy can wash himself and anoint himself and put his faith on and keep his mouth shut till it's time to speak it, and then speak it and watch it happen. Laboring to entering into that rest actually means you've done the labor part by cleaning up, getting ready, obeying God, and then He brings it to you and you eat the good of the land. Now, I believe God can take anybody in here and bless you like you've never thought you could be blessed before. Could be owning McDonald's. Go buy you a Chick-fil-A. I got that in my head. I preached a Bible one time, and this little 3-year-old granddaughter was going with us, and the granddaddy and the mama and me, and we was going to eat, and he said, "Where y'all going to eat?" And she said, "Oh, Chick-fil-A, Papa, Chick-fil-A, Chick-fil-A." And he wouldn't let her go. I said, "Oh, yeah, Chick-fil-A, that's where I want to go." Anyway, Chick-fil-A from then on. But anyway, I believe God wants to bless this church beyond our wildest imagination. And I believe He wants to use you to do it.
Yeah.
I believe He wants to set before us doors. And He's given us the keys. And if we will obey the Word of God in our life and in our situation, that the devil's going to hate us. But He's going to wish He'd killed us in Moab too. He's going to wish He would have got us when, way back when we wasn't saying nothing, just walking with God. Not running from him, but walking with him. Because we already know down in our knowers what he's going to do.
Come on.
Naomi done told her what was going to happen. He said he's under obligation through the covenant to marry him.
Yes.
I don't know if she was homely or not, but he got her. She didn't have nothing else going for her, I mean. It didn't matter if she was married before. It didn't matter that she had no children the first one. Then. He already knew she was broke. But he also knew she would work. He also had been watching her the whole time. That she hadn't went off to the bars and out chasing and all that stuff. That she was being faithful. See, he'd been watching her the whole time. And Jesus has got his eyes on you. He's been watching you the whole time. And he will give you what he shows you you can have. And you can be what God shows you you can be. Let me close. I'm on time, Brother Larry, this time. If I can get this closed, all right. I want it myself. I want it. I want what he's told me years ago. He told me when I come back here, them old prophecies and them old promises. It's going to come to pass. But I want somebody to want to be like me.
Come on.
You know, you produce what you are. You know what you say? You produce what you are. And that's why I'm proclaiming that little preacher got dedicated this morning. That my household's going to be blessed to 1,000 generations. Me and this one here come out of a curse, and we are not producing no more curses. But Ruth, not only did she get the field of Boaz, she got a legacy after she left. And I'm preaching about her today. I want to leave a legacy. How about you? When God takes me out through the grave, then I want Malvern to say that. We ain't never had no preacher like that.
Come on.
We ain't never had no church like that.
Come on.
That Malvern, God blesses us to the point we leave a legacy behind. Not just a family blessing and not just a personal, but a legacy for others to be blessed by. In other words, I want some poor kid that grew up in a divorce eating the free lunches at school. Didn't even get to know what a skating rink was till he's 12 years old. All the other kids could twirl them girls and everything. I couldn't even stand up. And then them mean old buddies, I'd be walking the wall and they'd come out and knock me down anyway, you know. But I want some poor kid to come to North Mountain Assembly and realize what God can do with somebody. With not a preacher one in his family and be on something like this.
Yeah. Yeah.
You see what I'm saying? I want somebody to say, look how God has blessed him. Because they paid their tithes. They gave him a listen, I ain't worried about no salary. God has got my salary.
Amen.
See, well, I done proved him on that. And so I want to see it happen. It's a combination deal. God's sitting already on you. But you got to do your part. You can't just come up here and say you're doing it. You got to do it.
Yeah.
I mean, you got to have a real walking experience with God. Am I helping anybody?
Come on.
You understand what I'm saying? I'm going to close one more time, Brother Larry. I heard this story. actually was watching TV at this TV preacher up in Chicago, and he told this story, and I never could forget it. He said, people were testifying, and he said, this brother come up, and he said, he looked kind of rough, and he said, I let him testify, but I held a microphone just in case I had to snatch it back. Because you just don't know sometimes, you know, what people's going to say when they get a microphone. But the guy got to talking, and he said, Pastor, I know you don't know me, but I've been coming to this church now for the last 6 years. And he said, first year I got here, I was just fresh out of prison. I was on parole. He said, I didn't even have a job. And he said, I went down to the pawn shop, and I talked them into letting me pay out the lawnmower for a year's lawnmower. He said, I started mowing yards. And he said, before you know it, I paid off that lawnmower, and I went and bought me a new one. He said, the next thing you know, I had me two or three guys working for me. He said, I got contracts all over Chicago now. And he said, he said, I didn't even have a car. He said, I bought me a Cadillac after that first year. He said, but now, he said, I got me a Mercedes on order. He said, actually, last week I signed the contract. There was some restaurants over across in front of my apartments that come up for sale. Not one, a chain of them. He said, I put my name. He said, I don't even know how to read and write, but I went over and put my two X's on there, and I just bought these restaurants with this lawn bit. He said, I have went from right out of the jailhouse to I'm a multimillionaire, and it's all because I listened to what you said and applied it. I brought them tithes and them offerings up in here and said, I tried to do everything that I hear from this pulpit, and here I am today. I just wonder what God could do with somebody sitting here right here today in Malvern, Arkansas. Oh God, I tell you, it's literally infinity what he can do with you. If you will do what he says, I want to make it happen. How about you? Stand with me. Father, I thank you for your spirit. I thank you for your word. God, I thank you for this little book of Ruth. Lord, it's helping me more than anybody. It's helping me, God. I believe that you will make it happen. That we'll be so blessed, God. Not we'll change our family history. Lord, we'll leave a lineage and a legacy, Lord, to future generations to follow. Lord, my grandsons will be blessed. My great-grandchildren will be blessed. Lord, I believe, God, you can take a messy situation and turn it into a masterful portrait. God, I'm praying that this word that we've been given, it would get down into the souls and spirits of your people. And Lord, that you would literally take us from gleaning to owning. Oh God, from nobodies to the somebodies in Malvern. God, I believe that you want to bless people. You want to bless them with peace and joy. You want us to live a blissful life, Lord. God, that we will be something worth looking at, because we are connected and tied our lives to you. Lead us now, Father, I pray. Guide us to this altar service, Lord. I believe this is one of the most important words of God you've ever given me. Lord, I believe you want to literally make us what you did with Ruth and Naomi. Lord, not just saved from Moab, blessed in Israel. Not just in the house of bread, but eating and living and being a big part of the house of bread. God, move on people today. I ask you, Lord, if there's backsliders, there's people with sin in their lives that they want to wash today. They want to wash themselves and clean themselves. They want to change their situation. But they don't want to live like they were raised. They don't want to let their past affect their future. But they want to get cleaned up and anointed. They want to make some changes in their lives. God, I pray for those backsliders or sinners in here today that you would rule, you would speak to them. God, I ask you today to take the roofs that has been following you, that's been heading up and down their miles. Lord God, let them realize we've labored, now we want to enter into that resting place that we can be receivers. Move on us today, Lord. I pray it in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. If you're here this morning and you say, Brother Preacher, I'm not sure if I died today, I'd go to heaven. I want to get out of this old lifestyle I've been living. I'm ready for a real change. You may come to God before, but you still haven't changed. And you say, I'm ready for a real change. So you can't change nobody else. You can only work on you. You can't change your spouse, your children. You can't change your parents, your situations. All you can change is you, and then that will affect them. But if you need it, say, Preacher, I really want to change my life. I'm tired of it all. I want to get out from under a curse. I want to be blessed. I'm ready. I want to live for Jesus. If that's you, would you slip out of your seat and make your way to this altar? I know it's hard to do. I know it's hard to do. There's a lot of people in here. These people's prayed for you. These people love you. They're not your enemy. They're for you. These people have nothing to make them happier than to see your life change. If you're here and you say, Preacher, I really need it. I'm not sure if I've died. It's going to come down to death. Are you ready to die? It could be today. Until I see it happen. If that's you, would you come find your place up here around these altars?